And the problem, we all know it, we've got huge unemployment now. Before the collapse a few years ago, it was 4%. Now it's 14%. We have substantial emigration. There's probably very few people in this room who don't have a friend or a cousin or a son or a daughter who's had to emigrate either permanently or temporarily in recent times. We still have major problems in the public finances. We're going through further cuts in the public sector, which is absolutely needed in terms of us ultimately getting out of our mess. Now, we have two choices then. As someone much wiser than me said, we can sit in the darkness and curse the darkness, or we can light a candle. So effectively, we're going to have to light lots of little candles to light the way forward in terms of the economy. And I wouldn't for one moment suggest that the universal toolkit is the answer which will generate 10 million tourists as opposed to 6 million tourists, but it's certainly a significant advance in trying to generate something that we have been relatively weak on. We've been weak on repeat tourism. Now, to some extent, you can't avoid that. That if an American family decides we'll do Europe this year, well, they're not going to do Europe next year and the year after, but maybe they will in 5 or 10 years' time. So what we have to do is try and, first of all, increase the number of tourists coming, and in addition, to generate a better repeat business. And in fact, there's no such thing as having the best tourist experience. It could always be better. So there's a continuous need to strive to make that better, 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 because we're in a very competitive world. Once upon a time, we thought of our tourism as people come to Ireland because it's a wonderful place. We have castles and culture and rain that you can't find anywhere, which we don't market sufficiently. But equally, there are lots of other places in the world. There's lots of other locations, and there's huge competition to attract tourists to Ireland as opposed to other countries. And as our traditional markets of old emigration and knock-on descendants, as it were, declines, we'll have, by and large, a less role for Americans, a lesser role for British, and a bigger role for the what might be called independent tourists of the world who are making decisions. We have a number of strong economic possibilities for the future. One of those is the food industry. One of those is our continuing ability to attract foreign direct investment, notwithstanding recent tax issues and so on. And the third one is our undoubted ability in terms of tourism. Now, tourism has declined in numbers. There's lots of problems, hotels with major borrowing problems and so on, difficulty for restaurants to get bank credit and so forth, cost of labour. Lots of difficulties still exist. And numbers have declined since the peak before the collapse in 2007. But recently, numbers have started to increase again. But we have tremendous potential to try and increase those numbers fairly dramatically. And one of the things that struck me about the Universal Design Kit was that before reading it, I thought I was perfect. I thought I was able, no problems whatsoever. And then I started to read what it was actually aimed at. And I realized, yes, without my glasses, I can barely see anything down there. The knees aren't the best for walking up lots of stairs carrying cases. Menus I do find kind of difficult, and websites generally are incomprehensible unless you've done them about 10 times and know exactly what you're looking for. And as the previous speaker mentioned, I find directions on websites worse than nothing, that you end up more confused by it than advised by it. So there is certainly a need to increase the quality of communications to users, to customers. But not alone that, one thing in particular has struck me about the universal design philosophy, that it's designed to make consumer communications accessible, meaningful, useful to the widest number. Before thinking about it, I probably would have thought there's able-bodied and disabilities. But now I realize that it's a continuum. There's few of us are perfect physical and mental specimens, and there's few of us who can't benefit from better communications and so on. So the primary business case involved in this is that it's not exclusive. It's not saying we're targeting this at the expense of this other group, as it were. It's making universal communication. And in fact, that's the key word, I think, in it, that it's universal. It's not segmented. It's not designed for old people. It's not designed for young people. It's not designed for active. It's not designed for sedentary. It's designed universally in a way that everyone can gain something from it. Another thing that's particularly desirable about it is that it's not particularly costly. And it's like these very simple ideas that are very useful that you end up saying, why didn't we do that ages ago? Why don't we have better communications? Why don't we have more direct talking? Why don't we have better interaction? And of course, the benefit of this particular package is it doesn't cost lots of money to implement, because every organization has a communications policy, strategy, resources devoted to it. They may do it fairly badly, they may do it in a way that's ineffective, but the point is that they do it. They continuously revise it. And of course, the benefit of these toolkits are, as they're being revised, they can be used in terms of the guidelines in these without additional cost. In fact, it probably will even save money in terms of what they would have done on an individual basis. So by and large, I think it's one of the kind of ideas that we're desperate to find nowadays. It's something which is enhancing economic performance. It is something which is socially desirable. It's not hugely expensive, and it basically has very few downsides attached to it. If we take one area, which has been identified in the background documentation on this, if we take the older segment of the population, I'm not quite sure what the politically correct term is. Is it elderly, older, over 50s, 60s, 70s? By the time most of you, because you're young, go to retire, probably the elderly will be over 80, because you'll be working till you're 80, given the state of the public finances. But that apart, if you look at the older group of the population, and again, the older group of the population have a range of difficulties in communication. Whether it's hearing, whether it's sight, whether it's understanding accents and so on, which can be very different. But they're a huge element of the tourism industry. They're the richest segment of the tourism industry. They go on more breaks than the younger segments of the tourism industry. They have more discretion. And in a sense, because they have more discretion, they have to be sought after more actively. So you're basically trying to persuade them to come to Ireland or to stay in Ireland. Whereas they have the choice, they're not working, they have the money, at least lots of them still have the money, so they can choose anywhere in the world to move. Now, I don't minimize to any extent the kind of things that we will need to get out of our economic difficulties. They are tremendous. We are light years away from where we were in 2007. We will be light years before we get back to where we were in 2007. But every little help is desirable. And particularly, as I say, tourism is a critical area of the economy. And what we have with the Universal Design Kit is, by and large, practical, logical common sense. And as we know, unfortunately, common sense is not all that common. So it's particularly welcome to see something that's precise, concise, not hugely expensive, assists the development of an important sector of the economy. And I must say, the National Disability Authority, quite apart from looking after its own constituency, has done a major service to the tourism industry and to business in general in simplifying in terms of these universal kits.